We'll go ahead and get started this evening. Good evening. Thank you so much for being here. It's so good to see everyone. Let's be in prayer for tonight's service. We have Brother Steve Payne. We'll be bringing our message tonight and our teaching. So let's be in prayer for him and what the Lord has on his heart. Let's also be in prayer for other classes that's going on. We have our college and career class. We have our youth, and we have the little ones also tonight. So we're going to be playing and singing with them here in a little bit. And I saw some of them bringing in their drums and their guitars and their ukuleles and all sorts of things. So we're excited to play with them. So just be in prayer for that. Also, our homecoming, of course, is this Sunday. So be in prayer for our services. And but I love you guys so much. Just be in prayer for the ones that are sick. We have so many in our church, as Pastor Mike mentioned, I think it's Sunday. We have quite a few pages, you know, of people who are sick and just going through so much right now. So I know we've gotten some texts over the last few days of different ones who's been taken to the hospital or that of that nature. So it's just being prayer for them. But I love you. It's just being prayer for tonight and other classes and other churches too. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we love you and thank you. And we ask you, Lord, that tonight you will just help us to glorify you. And Lord, we just want to lift this song up to you tonight, Lord. And just above everything, Lord, we need to focus on you. Above everything, Lord, it's you that we need. And Lord, just help Brother Steve tonight, give him the words to say. Lord, we ask you just to help him to get through his lesson, Lord, and you will just use his words and everything, Lord, everything that's said and done on this stage, and glorify you, and Lord, just glorify yourself. You know, I pray, amen. If we can, let's stand. If you'll just sing with me tonight, Lord, I need you. Let's just sing to him, sing our praises to the Lord tonight.
Uh-huh.
thank you. Thank you for being our one defense, Lord, and our righteousness, Lord. We love you. And above everything, Lord, no matter what, Lord, we need you each and every day. We need you each and every time we come into this house, each and every time we open your word. So, Lord, be with us tonight. Open up your word with us, Lord. I pray you'll just show us something. Show us something tonight we haven't seen before, something we can apply to our lives. Love you, thank you, and I pray. Amen. Love you, Steve. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, Trey. It's good to see everyone out tonight. It's always good to see your New Hope family. Those of you that are watching via Facebook, YouTube tonight, we certainly pray that the Lord will bless you real, real good and hope you get something out of tonight's lesson. And, you know, most people come to church on Wednesday night really not expecting God sometimes to be here. They just come and we go through a lesson and we just sit there and then we just leave and we go home. But he said, where there's two or three are gathered in his name, the Bible said he'd be in the midst. And I'm glad tonight that he's here. If you need him tonight, he's here. If there's anything you need of the Lord tonight, he certainly is here. And I hope that this lesson blesses you real, real good. I'm thankful always for the opportunity when Pastor asked me to stand and teach. And he'll be in a few minutes. I told him we wouldn't get on the pastor part of the lesson until he got here. So we're waiting on him. But it is good, to be here and so thankful. So much to be in prayer for. Still so many sick. And, you know, it's just, you're blessed beyond measure to be here tonight. You could be sick. You could be on a vent somewhere. You could be in a hospital, unable to be here. But you're here right now in this moment. The Lord has blessed you and he's blessed me. And I'm so thankful for that. And I never want to fail to give him praise and honor and glory for that, because he is worthy of all of that today. I want to talk about some things. Our lesson actually is going to be on restoration out of Joel chapter 2. But before we go there, I want to go to the Lord in prayer. And then I want to talk about five reasons to keep going when you want to quit. Now, how many of you this year in 2020, now be honest, have really wanted to quit? Several times. Several times this year, I just want to throw up my hands. Whether it's spiritually, whether it's business, whatever it is, you just want to throw your hands up and go, God, what's going on here? I just want to give up. But let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then I want to go through these five things real quick before we get into the lesson. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this opportunity tonight. And God, we pray that your word will go out tonight just where you want it to go. And God, that we'll teach it the way you want it to be taught. And God, hide us behind the cross. And Lord, may you get the glory and honor and be magnified and lifted up tonight, God, because you're worthy of all the praise. Thank you so much for New Hope Baptist Church. Thank you that it's 40th homecoming this coming Sunday. Thank you for 40 years here of preaching the gospel, and all those that have labored for all those years, we're so thankful for them and thankful for our pastor who stands time after time and preaches us the gospel. May it encourage us, may it excite us about who you are and what you're doing in our lives. And Lord, we just thank you for all that you've done for us. Continue to bless our church. Lord, we ask you to remove these diseases and these sicknesses, Lord, and help us to get back into a state of mind to worship you and to lift up your holy name. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I was talking to a pastor friend of mine this week, and he said this. He said, Steve, before I became a pastor, I heard people in the ministry joke about how they wanted to quit almost every Monday. I laughed, but I didn't really understand. Then I became a pastor, and the light bulb came on. That's what he told me. Or should I say, the reality set in. He says, we have seen in recent days ministers who have quit or are no longer serving in the ministry because of burnout, emotional pain, emotional stress, moral failures, alcoholism, just to name a few. We can all put ourselves in some of those categories this year. But he said here, the list could go on and on. He goes, the reality is, it's just devastating. It's just devastating. So what do you do when the moments come and you're ready to throw in the towel? As I said, I've been there this year. Some hands went up throughout the congregation. What do you do when it's time that you're ready to throw in the towel? You start saying these things in your mind or to yourself or to your spouse. I'm not cut out for this. I'm exhausted and don't have anything else left to give. You ever said any of those things? I'm exhausted. I have nothing else left to give. Do you know I'm a deacon here at the church, and standing in front of you and Facebook and everybody live, the truth is just the truth. You know, I work in Pigeon Forge, so I spend an hour driving back and forth, and I have a t-shirt business that was part-time that's about 40 hours plus a week on top of me working in Pigeon Forge and trying to teach, trying to spend time with my wife, who is so patiently loving that she'd probably like to slam my head in the door many times because I don't spend enough time with her. I'm spending time and doing other things. But even neglect of my families, sometimes being a deacon, we have, I would say, roughly 15 families apiece that we call and check on and those things. And I look back and I'm going, for the last month or so, I haven't done that. And I start making those excuses. Lord, I'm just exhausted. I don't have anything else left to give. So if you're looking for a perfect teacher, you're looking at the wrong one tonight, because I've got my issues, okay? But I know God's in control. No one really understands what I'm going through. You ever say that? You ever feel that way? Well, here are five reasons to keep going when you want to quit. You're doing better than you think you are. Just remember that. You're doing better than you think you are. Your emotions will lie to you. So don't let your emotions tell you you're worthless, you're good for nothing, things aren't going well. You're better than what you think you are. You see, when King David was discouraged, he found strength in the Lord. If you go over and read 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 6, David, he stopped looking outward and he started to look upward. He remembered who he was, but more importantly, he remembered who God was. He never forgot that, and we never should forget that either, who God is and what he's doing in our lives. So you're doing better than you think you are. Number two, you're farther along than you think you are. Thank God for what he's carried you through. Think about these things. If you don't have already, start you a gratitude journal and write down things every day that God's done good for you, and keep that journal. You'll find out that there's so many things in your life that you should be thankful for. That song says, I've got so much to thank you for, so much to praise him for, because you see, he's been so good to me. We could all say that tonight. We all come into church. We should come into church with praise and thanksgiving on our hearts and on our lips. Sometimes we don't, because I come in and I'm going, God, you know I have so much stuff I need to get done and what I have to do. And I'll be thinking about that sometimes while the preacher's preaching or while Trey is singing, because the devil wants to occupy everything about us here so we don't want to worship him. We don't come in the mind to worship him. Number three, God's doing more than you currently see. You see, our world loves to glorify finished products. Well, tonight we're going to talk about restoration a little bit here just in a few minutes. But God's in the business of magnifying a work in progress. Don't let what's wrong with the circumstances around you that keep you from worshiping God who is alive in you. Remember that. The third part of the Godhead is alive inside of you tonight if you are a child of God. Don't let circumstances weigh you down where you can't worship and bring to life and stir up that gift that's in you to praise him and give him honor and glory tonight. Everybody sitting here tonight, we're way blessed. We're not in the hospital where we know so many people are. We're not at home with COVID or in a hospital or on a vent. That ought to give us enough right there to shout the house down tonight. But we're going to talk about restoration. Just remember that word. God's doing more than you currently see in your life. Number four, there are people in your community that need what you have. When those moments come that you feel like you want to quit, just remember, you're doing better than you think you are. You're further along than you think you are. God's doing more than you can currently see. He's still working on me. Remember that song? And number four, there are people in our community that need what you have. I don't have much, Pastor. The little lady had 2 pennies. But what did she do with them? She gave her all. See, God just wants out of you and us. He just wants our all, whatever that is. Lance's all may be different than mine, but he just wants your all, Lance. He wants my all. Pudge, he wants your all. He wants our all tonight. People in our community need what you have. And you have a story to tell. You have a story to tell where God has brought you from and what he's done in your life and all the obstacles that he's opened up and you've come through. You have a story to tell. If you could all sit down tonight and do a journal or write the first chapter of the book and you started writing down all the goodness of God, you may not make it just in one chapter. It may be multiple chapters because God's been good. He's been so good, folks, to us. For 40 years, this church hasn't been wandering around in the wilderness. Did you think about that this week, Pastor? Is that your sermon for Sunday? The church hasn't been wandering around in the wilderness for 40 years. The hand of God has been on that little sanctuary where we have Sunday school, this place. God is here. I felt him the first time I ever set foot in this building, the very first time. Surely, I said, the Lord is in this place. And he's still in this place. During COVID-19 or COVID-20 or COVID-21, the Lord is still in this place. And he wants to do a work in you, and he wants to do a work in me, and he wants us to be excited about who he is. Who he is. Why are we here? Why do we have the jobs we do and make the money we do and have the health to do those things? It's all because of him. It's all because of him. So we give him praise and honor. But there are people in the community that need what you have. There are people in the community that need to hear the story that you have. You see, couple things. It's why we're all ministers. We're all ministers spreading the gospel. It's why you entered into the ministry in our first place, to reach those who haven't been reached, right? That's why we entered, to see one more life changed by Christ. The greatest, single most exciting thing is to lead someone to Christ, is to watch them bow on their knees and cry out to a holy God to forgive their sins and to come in their life and to become their Lord and Savior and their master. That's the single most rewarding, exciting thing you'll ever experience. You have what they need to hear. So don't bottle that up. It says, when you're hurting or discouraged, we forget this. Sometimes, as a Sunday school teacher, as a deacon, when I'm hurting or I'm discouraged, and I get that way, you may not. But when I do, I forget this sometimes. It's not that we don't care. We just tend to get lost in the details. You see, when we lose our way, or we lose our way when we lose our why. Why are we here? We're here tonight to worship and praise him. That's why we're here, because he says, enter his courts with praise and thanksgiving. You hear me say that a lot, but he really means that. Enter his courts with praise and thanksgiving. Now, if we come in and the weight of the world is on us and everything is dragging us down, we're discouraged about life, we're discouraged about our jobs, we're discouraged about COVID-19, we're discouraged about these things, we're not going to come in here with a mind of worship. We're not going to come in here spiritually set in our minds to worship the Lord because he's been so good to us. We're going to come in here with everything else on our mind. Revelation chapter number 2. Let me flip over here real quick and read that to you. Revelation chapter number 2 and number 4 and 5. I want to read this to you. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come to thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of this place, except thou repent. You know, I thought about a couple of weeks ago on the 9 a.m. service, I taught in Ezekiel chapter 37 about the valley of dry bones. And I use that spiritually speaking, is you could come to church for 40 or 50 years and be just as dry as the vision of those bones that Ezekiel saw. You could come and have no emotion whatsoever. You could come and have no praise and no worship and feel just like that. You and I can. But that's not what God desires. He said, can these bones live again? And I say spiritually. If you're down and out, if you're discouraged, if you don't know what's going on in life or the world, and you just feel like you have the weight on your shoulders, you've got to find yourself at the altar of God. There's a song we'll play at the end tonight. How long has it been? How long has it been? How long has it been since you felt those sweet loving arms of God wrap around you and hug you and squeeze you and it tells you that I love you and I'm here for you? How long has it been? How long? You see, this is a challenge to you and I. And lastly, number 5, when you want to quit, stop carrying the burden, share the burden. What does that mean? It's not the burden that will crush you. It's how you carry it. It's how you carry it that will make it all the difference. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Well, that doesn't sound some days like I carry around. It don't seem too easy and it doesn't seem too light, does it? There's times it seems heavy. That's when I need to fall on my knees the most and call out to a holy God who's nigh. The Bible said he's nigh to even in our heart and our lips. He's close. I sit sometimes with Donna's phone, and she has this astrology thing on her phone where we can sit outside and we can pull up the planets, and they feel like they're just in your hand. You can just kind of hold them. And it just seems like it's sad. And God goes, I'm just that close. And then I look and go, how far is Saturn from here? You know, and it's light years away or millions of miles, but yet these eyes can see that. God goes, I'm that close. I'm that close to you. So I want to say today, when you get in a state that you want to quit, just remember those things. God's doing more than you can currently see. You're further along than you think you are. There are people that need what you have. It may not be much. You may think it may not be much. Sometimes I think it's not much, but people out there need what you've got. You see, sometimes I always think back, and I talk to JD quite often, and we talked about, I said, JD, I'm 58 years old, so I'm pushing 60, you know, and I thought, my greatest desire is to see the church worship like it did when I was 15 and 16 and my 20s, that people got out of their cars in the parking lot and they began to talk about the Lord. They began to talk about the goodness and what he had done for them and how he had blessed them and things he had done for them. And they began to cry out in the parking lot before the church service ever started. They'd come in the door shouting and praising the Lord. And you'll say, well, I don't shout. Let the Lord squeeze you up sometimes. You may cry and shout everything. Let the Lord just hug you up real good. How long has it been since you felt that in your heart and in your life? How long have you desired that the Lord just squeeze you up and hug you and tell you that he loves you? How long? You see, we're not meant to carry burdens alone, but we're meant to share them. In Galatians chapter 2, he says, "Bear ye one another's burdens, so fulfill the law of Christ." We must be there for each other. And I believe at New Hope, we are there for each other. I think that's what makes this church special. Now, just with that prelude, I got to check my time because I'm really bad about... Oh, I'm doing okay for right now. We're going to go to Joel chapter 2, verses 25 and 26. And I want to read you something there as we talk about tonight, restoration. We talk about restoration. What is God wanting to do for you? He's wanting to restore. David asked the question, "God, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation." Didn't lose his salvation, did he? He said, "Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation." Sometimes we lose our joy, and we'll talk about that restoration here right now. Joel chapter 2, and verses number 25 and 26 of this chapter. Let me back up and read a couple verses so you'll kind of understand that. And he said, "Fear not," in verse 21, "Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beast of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring, for the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately and will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain is the first in the first month." Verse 24, "And the floors shall be full of wheat, and the fat shall overflow with wine and oil." And he says in verse 25, "And I will restore to you the years that the locust has eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you, and ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God that hath dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed." I'm glad today that God restores. He restores. According to the world, restoration means to bring back something that is old, something that's worn out, dilapidated, or broken back to its former state. Things that need restoration are things that have over time been allowed to slip into a state of neglect or disrepair. My father-in-law, when we first got married, he had a 1955 Chevy that he kept until just a few years ago. Many years he kept it. But he told the story to me. He said, "When I bought this 55 Chevy, it was old and dilapidated and rusty, and it looked bad. But," he said, "I went and I bought it, and I brought it home." Now, I want you to think about that spiritually. Well, I'm talking about an old car. It was old and rusty. It needed repair. And he said, "I brought it home and I began to cut rust out and I began to put new metal in. And then it got to a point it was ready to prime. And I primed it. And then I sanded it. And then I put new wheels on it. And I put a new motor, rebuilt the motor in it. And then I painted the final coat on this car, and now it was more beautiful than it was the day that it was pulled off the assembly line." You see, Job, who lost everything, if you'll read that book, he got twice as much back in the latter, didn't he, than he had at the beginning. You see, you and I are a blessed people today. We're no different than that car. We're no different than that valley of dry bones. If we sit long enough and do nothing and worry and have anxiety and all of these things, we're just like the car resting under the tree. The devil has you and me right where he wants us to be. You see, things that need restoring, sometimes they slip into a state of neglect and repair. That car at one point was brand new. It came off the assembly line and someone bought it, and it was new. You ever bought a new car, and for the first little while, you will keep it so spotless and clean. Any fingerprint on the window, you're there at the Windex, or you're a window cleaner, man, you're getting every spot off of it. You're washing it like every day, and you're shining the tires. And when it's new, that's what you do, right? You try your best to keep it clean. But after a while, the newness will wear off. And if you don't think as a child of God, the newness will wear off, you've missed it. When you first get saved, you're on the phone. I mean, we didn't have cell phones when I got saved. I mean, you were on the phone telling everybody what had happened to you at church that night at revival. That's exactly what we do, isn't it? But see, that car, you and I, we were in that state of, we had just sit out and rusted. And sometimes spiritually speaking, like the valley of dry bones, that's just how we'll be. But God restores you and I. But it takes us finding our prayer closet. It takes us bending on our knees and crying out to a holy God to restore unto us. You know, God, take this section of my life, this bitterness or this hate or this addiction, whatever it is, take this, Lord, and polish that thing up. Put some new metal in it. Paint it up. Restore unto me that joy. How long has it been since you and I really come to the altars and cried out to God to restore that joy and that feeling? Do you remember the last time God put his arms around you and just hugged you and loved you and you just cried? Do you remember that? See, that's who he is. That's who he is. Restoration, according to the word of God, is different from the worldly restoration. While the world says that restoration is bringing something back to its original state, the biblical definition of restoration or godly restoration means bringing something into a state where it would even be better than the original. I'm so glad today I'm better than I was the day God saved me. Aren't you? I'm so glad I'm better today. You see, Job 42 and 12, the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than the beginning. How many of you believe that God has a restoration for you? How many of you really believe that with all your heart? Of everything you've went through this year, everything our churches went through and our countries went through and going through, how many of you really believe that God has a restoration for you? That he has a restoration for your household? That he has a restoration for your family? That he has a restoration for your health, whatever you're going through? For your finances, God has a restoration? How many of you believe those things today? That the God in heaven, Jesus Christ, our Savior, that wants everything good for his people, how many of you really believe that's exactly what he has in store for you and I? Well, a couple things. Maybe we've allowed spiritual things, holy things, godly things to slip into a state of neglect and disrepair. Maybe we've done that. Can the rest of 2020 be a restoration for you? If it is, you're going to have to start on your knees before an almighty God, and I'm going to have to start on my knees before an almighty God, crying out to him and asking him for some restoring in my life. Some areas in my life that I need this restoration. Sometimes I want to quit, just like I told you. Sometimes I have neglect, like calling the families that I'm responsible for as a deacon of this church. Sometimes I'm not on the phone because I make up all those excuses. Lord, I'm too busy. I've got too much on me. You know I can't do that. I don't have time. I'm just pouring my heart out to you tonight, folks. Can the rest of 2020 be a restoration for you? There needs to be a restoration of our relationship with God. There needs to be that. Let me ask you a question tonight. Is there anybody in the house that's more spiritual now in 2020 than you were in 2019? Anybody? You're closer to the Lord and you're more spiritual now than you were a year ago? Most of us, if we're honest, we'll just shake our head and say, no, we're not. We're not. In order for restoration to take place, we have to acknowledge that there exists a disrepair and a neglect on our part. You see, I asked the question early, why did we come tonight? We should have come for praise and worship, because the God that let us be here tonight is the one who deserves all of that praise and honor and glory. Notice, I said, we've drifted. We've not run away. We've not given up the faith. We've just drifted. David drifted, didn't he? A man, the Bible says, after God's own heart. He drifted. Remember, when church attendance was one thing we used to put on our calendar as mandatory. Check Sunday morning, check Sunday night, check Wednesday night. That was part of, it was just automatic. We put the check marks there because that's what we were doing on those time slots, right? Now it's kind of just optional. Will we get in a state where the devil just keeps us in that mind that we can just stay away, we can just stay at home and get just as much out of the service as we can be in here? You can't. There's something about a body of worship, it's hard to explain. Because when you gather in here and I hear somebody talking about the Lord, how good he's been, and I hear somebody testifying to somebody else, and somebody else talking about the goodness of God, and this healing from that prayer that we had been praying for so long, when you begin to heal that, and the Spirit begins to flow breast to breast, something begins to happen. God's too big. When we all begin to talk about how good he is, he shows up because he's too big. We can't put him in a bottle when we come with that frame of mind. Worship was once a vibrant and loud. It's become tired and scattered. The valley of dry bones, spiritually deprived, not recognizing the goodness of God. And I have to find myself on an altar saying, God, forgive me. Forgive me. And put into me the joy that I once had. Put into me that joy that I need in my heart, that I can come to the house of God to worship and to lift up your name. You see, we've become what the Bible defines in Revelations as lukewarm, if we're not careful. We become lukewarm. I'm not talking about New Hope. Listen, we're a healthy church. Compared to many churches across this land and country, I want to tell you something. This is a healthy church. How many people can have services like we have and missing 200 and 300 people most times, and the people still provide in the offering, still provide in the giving? You know, that's a sign of a healthy church. I always say, if the Lord has your heart, he'll have your pocketbook. And the church keeps giving. And those people may not be here, may not be able to be here, but they just keep giving. That's a sign of a healthy church. But what I'm asking you and what I'm asking me is, if I'm not careful as an individual, I become just like this church in Revelations, and I can look in the mirror and I can tell that I'm lukewarm. I can tell that I'm lukewarm. Only you can tell that about you. And I'm lukewarm, and God will tell me in the mirror, you need to be hot or cold, buddy. Because if you're lukewarm, I'll just spew you out. It makes me sick. That's exactly what God's saying in there. It just makes me sick. So it challenges you and I to find our altar and never be afraid to use it. I often thought about church. What would it be like? And I've said this many times. What would tonight be like if we give the altar call before the singing? What would it be like for Pastor Mike if he give the altar call and everybody here that the Lord's dealing with, or you're carrying this big sack of stuff around all day, all week, what would it be like for you to come up and lay that down at the feet of Jesus before the singing and the preaching ever started? Don't you think there'd be a few more amens when the pastor's laying it out there and he's telling us the truth? Sure there would be. Don't you think there'd be a few more hands raising and praising the Lord when the choirs begin to sing and pudges begin to play? Sure there would. Why? Because our hearts are clear. We've just poured them out to God. We've brought everything to the altar before the service ever started. Think about that. How do we come to church sometimes? How do we come? Revelations 3, 15 and 16, he says, I know your works. You're neither hot or cold. Would that you be hot or cold, but because you're lukewarm, I'll just spew you out of my mouth. So what happened? God's still the same. I've always said it. I'll continue to say it probably as long as I get to teach. God's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He changes not. This word is settled. It's the truth from Genesis to maps all the way through. It's true. It's God's holy word. Society won't change it. They won't take it away. They won't dismantle it. It is forever true. So what happened? If he's the same, then the happen had to happen with me and you, the church world as a whole. We become influenced by the world. We become spiritually complacent. We've bought ourselves idols which have replaced God. Romans 1 and 25 says we exchange the truth of God for a lie and worship and serve the creator, the creature more than the creator. That is so true if we go back and look. So why do we not come into the house of God and shout and praise God and give him glory and honor? I mean, when I look around and I see like Dawn, healthy children, God's given her and blessed her and Peter with. I look at my wife and my children and, you know, when I look at Nick and Nathan and Natalie and the grandchildren that he's given us and one on the way, why, I ought to be the most happiest person in the world, thinking that God's kept our family from COVID and from sickness, and we've got a job, and we've got money, and we've got a house to live in, and we've got food, and we've got more than millions of people all over the world. We've got more than they have, more than they'll ever have. We throw away more food than some people eat all year long. Why can we not come into the house of God and give him praise and honor and glory? Why can we not do that? How would you feel if God removed the candlestick from this place? You see, sometimes if we don't come in that frame of mind, now how many times, and I want you to listen to this, how many times have you heard the pastor from the pulpit, or me teaching, or Nick, or Doug, and what wonderful preachers that we have here, and a wonderful pastor. But from the pulpit, how many times have you heard the term, let's return to God? Let's return to God. How many times have you heard the phrase, let's return to a deep relationship with God again, like the one we used to have? Let's return to that relationship. Let God restore us. Let's cry to a God, the Father, to restore our relationship with him. How many times have you heard that over the pulpit? Let's break down all the barriers that block us and have a meaningful relationship with God. At the end of the day, is that not what it's all about? God give his very best, his son Jesus Christ, to come to this earth. He was born of a virgin. He came to this earth to be the savior of the whole world. Didn't matter what color you were, didn't matter what country you come from, didn't matter anything about you. He came to this earth to seek and to save that which was lost. And he gave his life on Calvary. And he was in the grave, in that borrowed tomb for 3 days. And he arose out of there victorious to give us life and to give us hope. You see, so many more people have went through so many more things than we have as a nation. I mean, COVID-19 has been bad and it's been disastrous. It's hurt economies, it's hurt families, it's killed people. It's done all those things. But God is not shaken. He's not nervous. He's in control. By the way, he already knows who wins the election. He already knows who's going to win all the elections as long as he tarries. He already knows all those things this morning. I think of that song, Why Should I Feel Discouraged? Or Why Should the Shadows Fall? Because Jesus is my portion. He's my all. Folks, he's that for you tonight. He's all of that for us. But we've heard the pastors say these things, that we need to return to God. We need a relationship with God. We need God to restore a relationship. But you know what happens most time? And as I said, when I taught on Ezekiel 37, the valley of dry bones and sometimes being dry spiritually, I'm the chief. Paul, a sinner, said, I'm the chief. Well, I want you to know, I'm the chief, I feel like, sometimes. When the pastor's preaching all these things and it's coming across the pulpit, and I sit there on a bench and I occupy my space and I never do anything. I never move. I never shed a tear sometimes. I never have a praise in my heart or a song on my lip. I never have anything. And I get right up just like some of you. And I walk right back out those doors just like I came in, dry. And I say, Lord, what was wrong with the preacher? Now, you've never done that, I guess, right? What's wrong with the preacher? You know, and he'll go, that message was right to you, young man, right to you. So you see, restoration is what you and I need. That old car that needed repair, it come off the assembly line beautiful. The day Jesus saved me, he took away all my sin, and for that moment in time, I was just spotless. I looked pretty good, Pastor. I think he polished me up and combed my hair and all those things. And I look pretty good. But you know what? If you buy a new car today and you take it and you set it under a tree, it won't be long. It'll start getting really dirty. If you don't ever drive it, it'll just sit there. And over time, it'll get dirty. It'll get sap on it. And it'll just rust until someone comes and cleans it up. And you and I are no different as a child of God. Sometimes we need to be restored. Sometimes we need to scrape that rust off. Sometimes we need to just get back on the saddle and just keep riding. Sometimes we need to do that. And I'm so thankful today, and let's see, I'm just about finished, I promise. I want to play you a song. But there's some things that God wants to restore. And I want to give you these real quick. What kind of restoration does God want to do for you? A restoration of life. In John 14 and 6, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. So God wants to restore life in you and I. He is the life giver tonight. He's the only one that can give eternal life. And in John 11, 25, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. So if you want life this morning, it's in him. Number two, he wants to restore a vision. Proverbs 29:18 says, where there's no vision, the people, what? Perish. He wants to restore that vision. Do you have a vision? What is a vision? A vision is the ability to see the picture you see in your mind. I told JD, I said, my picture is people coming through those back doors, praising the Lord. I said, I want to see that in my lifetime again. I desire to see that. And I hope at New Hope Baptist Church that happens. Restoration of hope. Hope is one of the three theological virtues of Christian religion, alongside those two words called faith and love. Hope is right there. Hope in the Bible means a strong and confident expectation of future reward. In modern term, hope is to trust and be confident in something. Are you confident that what you've committed unto the Lord, that he's able to keep? Are you confident that you can come and bow on your knees and have a talk with Jesus and get things right in your life, that you don't have to tote this stuff around that you carry all way, all day, all week, all month? Maybe you've been carrying it since COVID started in March. You don't have to carry that around. You don't have to tote that around. Jesus Christ is close tonight. You don't have to wait till Sunday morning or Sunday night. If you've been toting this stuff around tonight, they're going to play a song as we finish. And I remember Sister Pat. The last song I heard her sing was this song. And I know she's looking down tonight, but the name of this song is How Long Has It Been? And I believe that's on, where's Trey? That's on number two. How long has it been? And I'll ask you again, how long has it been since you had that talk with Jesus and he hugged you up and said, I love you. I love you. I'm here for you. I've never left you. How long has it been since that's happened in your life? How long have you felt that? How long have you longed to feel that? Sometimes we come to church going, Lord, I hope you show up today. You know the services that we've had here at New Hope when the Lord shows up? Pastor Steele, I heard him do a revival when I was visiting here one time. I believe Pastor Steele was out of Charlotte, wasn't he, Pastor Mike? I was trying to remember who he was, but he said when the Lord shows up, he shows out. And so that is the same for you and I. So do you need to be restored tonight? You can come and be restored before you leave here and leave here a different person. If you're toting a whole bunch of stuff around that's just weighing you down, you can come tonight and be restored. If you're like the valley of dry bones, God can put muscle back on you. And then not only just the muscle, but he can breathe that breath of life back into you just like he did those bones. You see, there was no life there until he breathed in there. Just like Adam. Adam was perfect, but he was missing one thing, the breath of God. You and I need the breath of God, a refreshing in our lives. And we can come to church every service with a change of heart. We come here tonight to worship him. We come to praise him and give him honor and glory because he's worthy. Start your journal. What's he done good for you? What's he done good for you? Has he done things good for you that's worthy of praise and honor? Sure he has. Sure he has. Why don't we give that to him? As he comes, or as they play that song, if you need to come tonight, you come and pray and God will be there with you. Somebody will be there to pray for you. And if you're here tonight and you're lost and you have no idea what I've been talking about tonight, you're just like an old car just sitting there rusting. But Jesus Christ can take you and polish you up tonight. And he can make you a fit subject for the kingdom of God. And that worth that you thought it was worth nothing, he can make you far worth more rubies and diamonds. That's just who he is. Let's pray as they sing this, play this song tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Thank you for being here tonight, God. And we pray that you'll restore unto us the joy of thy salvation. God, areas in our life that you know that we're weak, areas in our life that you know that we struggle. God, I pray tonight that you would just help me, Heavenly Father, to put all my trust and to put all those things that hinder me, I give them to you, Lord. A lesson we taught once, it said, you did run well. So tonight, there's things that hinder us. And God, we need our worship back. We need our praise back. God, we're so thankful for our church and our pastor and everyone here. And we love them with all of our heart. And Lord, we long for the time where there's 400, 500, 600 people in this congregation that's praising you and that tears are shed because of how good you've been to them. Lord, we long for that. And we need that, Heavenly Father. We need to feel you to come into this place and put your arms around us and hug us tonight. Lord, and just tell us how much you love us. God, thank you so much for an opportunity to stand. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Go ahead, guys. Thank you. Thank you, church, so much. If you need to pray, the altar's open. You come and pray tonight.
How long has it been since you talked with the Lord? And told him your heart's hidden secret. How long since you prayed? How long since you stayed on your knees till the light shone through?
How long has it been since your mind felt at ease? How long since your heart knew no burden?
Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since
Since you knelt by your bed and prayed to the Lord up in heaven, how long since you knew that He would answer you and would keep you the long night?
Pastor, you want to take over? All right.